location or my presence here is one of restlessness. So tonight I kind of want to be a fidgeter, right? So I'm going to be fidgeting with theory for a moment. To begin, we think about something like sound and architecture. There's an obvious initial moment in which we all think about acoustics, yeah? So acoustics being some kind of relationship between sound and its presence within architectural space. So if I make a sound, we kind of understand that sound as having some kind of direct relationship to the material structure which is around us, right? So obviously the sort of basic fundamentals of acoustics being that the way in which that sound is sort of enters your ear is in a sense shaped by material construction of a given room. I wanted to sort of maybe add something to acoustics, which would be something like the idea that sound, in a sense, is always in more place, in more than one place at a given moment. Yeah? So if I make my sound, in a sense, it's both sort of here, but it's already immediately over there, but at the same moment, already over there. So that in a sense, acoustics is also about a kind of multiplication of place, kind of accumulation. So you could say that acoustics is in a sense all about sort of kind of sound sort of moving through the space and in a sense carrying that space and articulating it in different places at the same moment. To sort of see or hear the sound as it sort of moves from here to that wall or to that wall. Of course, there's a way in which it's immediately involved in your presence. So we don't want to forget about bodies. So that acoustics and the way in which sound interacts with architecture or something like rooms is also about a kind of social event. Yeah. So obviously, we can imagine that the sound of my hand clapping was much different before you all arrived. You're kind of immediately involved in acoustics. So there's a kind of material sonic event that in a way is also about social. So you're maybe seemingly silent, but you're also in a way producing or deflecting or affecting the sound of my hand clapping. You're kind of implicated. Don't imagine that you're innocent. Just to kind of maybe trail on with that for a moment, just to sort of say that if you think also in addition to the size of my hand clapping, if you consider my voice for a moment, you can also sort of think about the way in which I, as a kind of speaker, a sort of sound generating body, and in a sense pressurized into making a particular sound. Yeah? So I'm pressurized not only by the notion of acoustics affecting the sound of my voice, and therefore somehow influencing how I might speak. Do I raise my voice or do I speak quietly? But also there's a kind of social pressure. So we could call that something. So I stand here and I'm given a certain responsibility and I stand up and I'm supposed to sort of say something. And that something is, in a sense, directed by or contaminated or in a sense shaped by a certain social pressure. Yeah. So I speak, you all look towards me as a sort of source of sound. Yeah. And your gaze, in a way, is affecting or determining, to a certain degree, the sound of my voice. So I'm really like squeeze by your look. That squeeze, in a way, is in a sense shaping my voice. Does it tremble slightly? Am I nervous? Okay, so we have something like acoustics, material level, we have a social event. And just to sort of end, I wanted to add the psychological. Yeah? If we think back to the notion of sound multiplying place or space, so that this sound is more in one place and that infinite moment, we could also say that that sound, or if we think about my voice, coming from a single source, whether it's my mouth or my hands, you could also propose in a way that that sound is immediately inside of your head. You may look towards me through a certain distance, right? I'm over here, but my voice is immediately in your head. Yeah? So I may exist here, but I'm also living in all of your heads. Yeah? At this given moment. Okay. So those are my three kind of ideas for the night. My three fidgets. So I'm going to kind of be quiet now and pass things on over. Initially, we're going to hear from Justin Bennett. Justin is an artist working with sound and visual media based in Den Haag, the Netherlands. He is best known for his work with field recordings, which he uses to build spatial sound installations, audio tours, CDs, and live performances. He has collaborated with many artists from the worlds of electronic and improvised music, and is a founding member of the performance group EMB.com.
Some people suddenly think you can't hear what I'm saying and shout at me. Then, ready? No? Okay. That's great, because I'm Brandon. I don't have to say anything about who Brandon is. Introduced, kind of video. What I'm going to do is I wrote too many notes. I even have to stop one. I'm going to read some things and hopefully have you and play some sound. And I'll end up also kind of performing. But I'm still dubious about this idea of performing like me sitting behind a computer. It still feels strange. And that's something I can do. sound for the place. So I'm just going to wait for the recording of the place. Show you a little. I'm going to play a sound. I've got this screen. I mean, it's a screen over there. It's also a screen over there. That's where I'm looking. So this is just. I'm going to show you the screen. This is a piece called Waiting Room. And we have to wait. This, for some reason, it takes ages for the sound to start. It's also a really bad picture. But this is a sound piece for. Actually, also. This is so high tech. But this is a waiting room on a station in Holland with all the noise and station. And I made this kind of sound which was also played. faces from, you know, sounds from other railway stations, but also markets, streets, large public buildings. People are sitting there waiting, you know, for the announcement, and then suddenly it's an invasion of their space. I'll wait for the next sound. I can't remember what it is. And then this kind of pause. This is the pause in the drum. She couldn't hear it, so you have to listen to the other sounds. Especially the people who are concerned with the study of the soundscape. We think of the soundscape as being the acoustic equivalent of a landscape or a cityscape. The study of the soundscape comes from a Canadian poet called R. Murray Schafer. He set up this thing called the World Soundscape Project, which was an idea to document the changing soundscape of the world, especially as changing technology and industrialization. And so they were kind of following things, following soundscapes, following ecologies of sound. They call it. Now they're called the World Forum for Acoustic Ecology. They're changing the name. And the study is really a mixture of ecology, sociology, architecture, of course, music, language, and politics. I'm not going to go into it too much. Very interesting what they're doing, but I think the most important concept is that the soundscape is not just the result of the environment. The soundscape is not just the sum total of, you know, like people in this building making noise and cars outside. You can think of it like adding everything up, and if they say, okay, that's what we're listening to, that's the sound. The idea is that the soundscape is the environment. So to actually change soundscape. You can't make rules about sound. You can't say, for instance, make laws about you can't play the music is loud or that kind of thing. That never works. What you really have to do is change the environment itself. So two things are completely interconnected in that way. I've done loads of listening to cities and recording them. And it's very interesting, like the difference between cities. It's so complex that what makes a difference in sound. It's not just customs or climate or language, which all have an effect, but it's also very much architecture and building as well. There's a sort of tiny example. I've got some recordings from different squares. This is a recording of square in the evening. In Denmark, in the Hague, where I live. short example, but like listen, okay, there are very few people there. There's loads of traffic, and you hear lots of echoes. Big high buildings, glass from hard surfaces. So you hear these echoes of the traffic, squeaking brakes, that kind of thing. This is a similar sized square at the same time of day in Barcelona. So I mean, it's also very much about climate. I mean, you don't want to hang around at 9 o'clock at night, you know, in the winter in the Hague, in this winter square. But what they did in the Hague is it's a rich mayor that Shanghai went to be it, so big in a way. But it's got this atrium, this atrium, which is amazing. And it's actually become quite a successful public space. It's not even really public. It's like a town hall. And then the space inside of this, in a way, it's kind of taken over. There's a mix of this first way. It's kind of taken over the function of the public space. So if you listen to that, it sounds a bit more like Barcelona, but it's just outside. I mean, you're listening to recordings. We're not listening to the real space. We're listening to these things. You know, the sounds coming through these speakers. Making recordings really only makes it more complicated. It's thicker block. The sound, in fact, going back to what Brandon was saying before, sound is never alone. You know, when you make a recording in the environment, you enter into a relationship with the space and with things going on in space. You have to accept all kinds of things that might happen, all kinds of noise, all kinds of accidents, interactions with people, even aggressive reactions from people, for instance, or animals. That may be here. And I'm going to quote Brandon, because he wrote, I can't remember where he wrote it, turn your microphone on, but don't stop with your camera. Just to accept what comes to you. And you always engage with that. So listening is very inclusive. You can't listen to something which is in a space where you're not you always share a space with the sound source. So you kind of integrate in what's going on. How can you approach time-based and spatial combining music and architecture? Now I'm going to talk about music. I mean, sometimes we talk about sound art or whatever. I'm just going to say music, just to say that. When you're thinking about sound or music, okay, when you think about music and architecture, the first thing is that you can define the subject matter. There's so many ways to connect the two. There are so many connections already in place, there's like conceptual and technological links between the two fields. And recently, sort of trying to get sort of down to the nitty-gritty of it, I've been trying to also reduce the link down to listen to music, it unfolds, and it modifies our sensation of our place within time. It modifies our sensation of the here and now. What music does is it sets up temporal structures, or structures in time, and processes, which dynamically affect how we perceive the present. Now, if you look at architecture and urbanism change our sensation of place. It's all about sensation. They change our feeling of where we're placed within the space. So architecture creates, and our urbanism creates and modifies spaces by constructing or implying like physical boundaries in the space. So they're creating place by making boundaries in some way. Performing volumes, rhythms, sidelines, vanishing points. Talking about moving as a being, moving space and moving. And I like to kind of put these two things next to each other. You could see it, see the presence of music in place of architecture as being almost like byproducts. Some people see architecture and music as construction. You can construct space, divide up space, just like music. Divide up time, you score and you go, okay, right, not like what you're on a computer screen, the time goes that way, and you put the sounds down. But really it's about where you are at the moment, in that continuum, how you respond to it. So it's like kind of where the subject like engages in real time with the sound and with the space. That's what I'm interested in. The other thing is also really difficult to analyze this in any way, because this way of looking at architecture is very much experiential. It's about how we perceive it. You can't look at it from without. You can only look at it from within when we're inhabiting those spaces, or when we're inhabiting or following the history of music. So where do we go? To sum up, music and architecture mean to the body of the subject. That's about it. So that's kind of that's my summing up. But this is kind of the basis of where I'm sort of working, to theorize and have synthesis of architecture and music, or synthesis on the other hand, confrontations and interventions between the two things. Often in that case, what I show you now is very confrontation. So I'm going to skip that question. I'm just going to show you quickly a couple of other pieces. So I'm not going to talk too much about this. There's not that much to see here. This is an audio guide for the city of Den Haag. And this is the book that goes with it. So it's basically a walk. You go to this art centre and you borrow a walkman and you go for a walk. It's all in Dutch, so you probably won't understand it. But I can play you a bit of it. Actually, it's quite funny because this is this sound. I didn't realize this is without the text. And I can hear the speaker coming out of the speakers of my computer. I'm going to stop it because otherwise I'll get really confused. It's like the technology is taking over. But basically, what the story is your guide to the city is a conspiracy theorist obsessed with the ideas of vibration and radiation. He's taking you on a search for the secret sound of the city, to go around these places, telling you stories, and these things about vibration. I use lots of different techniques. It's really nice doing things like that. You just do anything you want. You speak to somebody completely new. So, you know, you've got to get them on this journey. You can do anything you want. So, using music, kind of like that cinematic thing, you know, soundtrack music, and narration, sometimes dramatic things happen. But it's very much relying on the sounds I'm working. The idea was is that it's a ridiculous project, to make recordings on all the European Union borders. Firstly, because I thought they're just interesting places, they're kind of like no man's land. Well, sometimes they're very, very busy points, you know, crossing points, but often they're just these places where, of course, it's like the EU almost doesn't look like. Go east. And I made this installation version, which I'll show you. I mean, it's just a room, not very much to see. But maybe the sound will come in. There's some kind of strange delay between the sounds and websites and something. In this installation, the program which chooses sounds from different borders. It combines them together into a kind of map, and then it does a walk through these sounds. You see, this is part of the software. And the shape of the walk is actually taken from one of these borders somewhere. So I've taken the border actually as a kind of compositional musical line. I was interested in the shapes of these borders. Very much. Sometimes they're natural curves. You know, they follow rivers or they follow mountains. Sometimes they're drawn in a movement. Sometimes they're, you know, it's armies fighting to negotiate the war. But what I really wanted to, the idea of feeling I really wanted to create with this was the idea of sort of absence. All these sounds, even when played into the smallest way, they create this kind of feeling of distance and empty. I was trying to, you know, it's a bit like the opposite of that other piece. This is about your place and trying to make it moving, trying to make almost like a kind of silence. It makes it about emptiness or absence instead of making your other kind of actor in this journey you're taking. So as Brandon was already talking about sounds as spatial phenomena, most of them know about acoustics and how sound moves through spaces and fills and it describes the space and the way to the ears. And so it should also be obvious that if we get a lot of cues about space from sound and acoustic and material shape, just changing soundscapes and other sounds in spaces can change our perception of space quite radically. What I do a lot in that piece as well is I use a computer to organize sounds in space and in time. And what's interesting about that, or complicated about that, is you end up with lots of kind of layers, different kinds of layers of space computers. I have this virtual space, which is the sound from the computer, and then you have the real space for playing the sounds. But also, often in my work, I have spaces which are recording that I've made in some different spaces. They're all these kind of layers of space which are difficult to kind of conceptualize. What I'm going to show you now, I haven't got much time, it's going to be a very short. idea, the first thing you have to do is to treat and organize sound recordings as spaces. Rather than normal music software, you treat sound as an event in place and time. This is about taking sound, placing it in space, and then being able to reach it. This is our space, empty space. And we can put a sound in. The other thing it does, the second thing it does, which you can't really hear here, is it makes translations between the stereo and the field recordings that I'm working with, and the surround sound set of the field recordings. So it does this kind of spatialization thing. So that's a sound. So I'm going to change the sound. It's the list of sounds. So we have that red dot is us. Yeah, that's the listener's position. And I can move it. So I'm moving us into the pantheon. Or on the other hand, I can grab the pantheon and move it somewhere else. So that's grabbing us. I can also go like this. What I can also do that's difficult to hear here is you can actually rotate the image with the sound. It's hard to hear on fixed speakers. You can spin the sound around the people. If you want to combine sounds, I'm just going to stop this set and load something. Although I still have to use the I'm going a bit over time, but I'm going to play with this. I'm going to choose different kinds of sounds here. Not that one. Difficult to see on the screen so far. My eyes must be going. What's out of focus? That one is this. Sorry. Bear with me. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take some sound that's actually used for a project in Rome. It's all recordings made in marketplaces. There's most of them. Processed version, and then I played it back into the marketplace itself. It's almost there. It's this one. And of course, now I'm going to play it back into this space, which is completely different. Let's see what it sounds like. So.
my name is Atu Tanaka. I'm going to be talking about ideas about social architecture, social dynamic, music, sharing, playing with music in ways that we don't think about while playing with instruments. All this being said, I am a musician. I'm not an architect. I'm not a sociologist. I've come to thinking of these ways through thinking about my music and what new avenues I have to pursue my music. So those who might know me from the music scene will probably be able to be able to present his sensor technology and his new digital instruments. I might give a little bit of background. And then those who have known me more recently might have heard also that I've been applying in a research lab with Sony. That was good. Yeah, I do want to share. So the question among some of those who know me a little bit better has been, well, so Atu, what have you been doing at Sony? Is it top secret? Well, no, it's a research lab. I'll get into it a little bit. We're not making products. We're making very strange, not even prototypes. So with all that being the kind of trajectory I want to spend in the talk, I will give a bit of a background about where I'm coming from. That's my text from the website, so that's on the website. That was just a reminder about what I'm thinking while I was here. So we back up about 10 years, 1993 or so. I was interested in sensor instruments. Making musical instruments, but using computer technology. However, that could liberate me, that could free me from having to sit behind a computer and use a mouse and type on the keyboard to perform. I was interested as a musician to continue using gesture and movement of my body, and still be able to exploit and benefit from the sound universe as possible with computers. So I've had projects where we've had bands, where each of us was dealing with ways to capture body movement in different ways, whether it be ultrasound on the left, infrared in the middle, or the beam with fire signals, to be able to articulate music by our body's movement. I haven't given that up, even though the work I'm presenting today is very different. So today, so 10 years later, I have a new band, a new trio, it's called Sensor Sonic Sights, SSS. The man on the left, Lauren Dio, is playing theremin, perhaps the oldest live electronic music instrument. I'm still playing biomix, it's picking up muscle signals. The instrument hasn't changed in 10 years. And Cecile Babiol on the right is working with ultrasound sensors as a musical instrument to articulate graphical images. So there is a contradiction in terms, to make a musical instrument for image. The visuals that you see projected there are coming from her. It's a sound and image project, but it's not sound being turned into image. It's not the synesthesia. We are three musicians. Two of us are making sound and one is making image, all related to the movement of our bodies. If I had more time, I would play videos and recordings of all this, but that's not really the subject of my talk. We'll see why this is important to you later. Okay, so that's us a little bit more in. I started to become interested in the idea of network music nearly 10 years ago, 95 or so, where I tried to organize concerts spanning different cities using video conferencing technology. So I would organize concerts based in Paris. I would set up concerts between Paris and New York. We played at the Sonar Festival in Barcelona in 97. Barcelona and Rotterdam, trying to use this network technology to see if we could connect two stages in distant cities, to see if we could keep the dynamic that we seek as musicians, the dynamic of live performance, on network infrastructures. And this too is something I've not thrown away. I did a large radio commission to the Southwest German radio about 2 years ago, a big radio drama, Hörspiel, called Again, I'm deep field with this, where I've written and something that brought together the idea of the sensor instruments and the network concerts was this idea of network instruments. Pretty logical. I had a piece called Global String that took a good bit of my time in 98 to 2000 or so. What you see there is an installation in a gallery space in Linz at Ars Electronica. You see a kind of diagonal cable. That for me is a giant guitar string. It's a steel cable about 16 millimeters thick and about 15 meters long, so kind of a massive, massive guitar string. And it doesn't end there. It goes into the wall, and in fact there's a sensor system that is picking up vibrations and movements of the string that are sending the data, digitizing the data, sending it up to the internet to another town. Because this is a musical string, the string has two endpoints. This is just one end of the string. You're just seeing the beginning of the string, and it goes off into the ether of the internet, and it arrives in another city somewhere else, in this case Budapest. And the other end of the string is there. So there are two physical ends of the string. The real, the body of the string is in fact the network. So I was trying to then start to build instruments. And all this led to a great deal of frustration. The first question, yeah, is net time not for performance? Well, when I was organizing these network concerts, the biggest problem was the latency, the time delay of sending data over video conferencing connection from Barcelona to Rotterdam or wherever. Sometimes it would take half a second. And if you play something and a half a second later it arrives across Europe and your musician friend, you see him face to face, eye to eye, but he plays back and it arrives yet a half a second later to you. There's been a 1 second delay. And are you able to react to that in a way that to me is natural as a musician? Well, I'm a musician dealing with experimental situations, so for me that was to say, okay, this is the acoustic of the space that I play in. When we play in a space, an acoustical space, we adapt immediately to the acoustic, to the reverberation. If I play in a jazz club, there are things that I can do that I can articulate there that might be different and not possible if I play in a theme. And indeed, you see that church music coming from these very large reverberant spaces are very, very different time axis than a Charlie Parkinson or the jazz clubs. So musicians have a very natural way to adapt to acoustics, the physical properties of space. And I wanted to extend this idea to network space to say, network performance, then, if it's a 1 second delay round trip, that's the acoustic in space on this plane. But that's a difficult proposition for most musicians. I could say that conceptually, I could build projects on this, but for quote-unquote normal music, this is perhaps a bit difficult. So I thought maybe the network, maybe the dynamic of time on the net is not so well suited for performance. So maybe that space of the net not really a performance space. So I started to think about what else do I know as a musician in dealing with time and dealing with space. Well, time was one thing, space is the other. So I started to think about, is the network space an interesting way to look at the way people come together to share a space in music and in sound. And to do that, I got away from performance and organizing concerts to look at installation situations. So this is a work called Constellation. It's very simple. You see four or five IMAX there in the gallery space. But each of them is connected to the internet. They're in one physical space, but each on its own network connection to stream in multiple channels of sound, creating a mix on each computer. Each mix on each computer being then totally mixed in the acoustical space of the gallery. So we're dealing with different levels of mixing, network mixing, and then at some moment I just decided, well, we'll just hit space and we're all together. We're using the internet, everyone just uses the net for a couple of things, email and surfing the web. And this has brought about new forms of art, we call net art, which are mostly works of art that you watch on a web browser or experience on a web browser. I was interested to see that could we transpose music to this new
canvas of artistic expression. Could we make a net music? So I did do a sort of a browser-based project called MP3Q, where in fact my act as a composer was no longer to make sound. My act as a composer was to make a place, which was not even a physical space. It was a place on server space. It was a program running, and that was my composition. It's a program that would display URLs. What were the URLs? They were pointing to sounds. What were the sounds? They were not my sounds. They were contributions from visitors to the web. So it was an empty piece, a contentless piece of music that would start to come to life only when people hit the add button and sent in a link to an MP3 file they had on their computer or on their server somewhere. And the more contributions there were, the larger this group of sounds became. And my job as a composer, my role as a composer was to just create this abstract environment where multiple, a collection of sounds like this could be mixed and blended in interesting ways. So now to answer the question that some people had, well, okay, so you're doing all this stuff with Sony. What does that mean? Well, it means that the place where I'm working in Sony falls under the name that we all know of the manufacturer of one and place. But it's a laboratory in Paris dedicated to fundamental research and research. So my job there is to transpose some of the concepts and ideas I had in my art as an artist into a scientific research arena. So if we then take some of these questions that I've been asking myself in a very intuitive way as a composer, just trying, seeking out musical satisfaction for myself with these technologies, with these instruments, with these infrastructures. If we transpose those intuitions and hopes, artistic hopes, into a kind of research language, almost an industrial language of a company like Sony, well, these are the words that we get. That performance creates spheres of interaction. That a musical experience, anyway, is a shared thing. And that we can consider a public gathering like this, or a concert, as a temporary situation of trust. We are all here because we believe in one thing, or we believe in many things, and we maybe disagree on many things, including what I may be saying at the moment. But something brings us together, and there's a certain notion of trust. And this becomes a very, very important thing. To use this word trust instead of the word security, since when we think about computer hacking and privacy and all this. So performance can map to trust. Is this a solution for security problems? Let's see. Time and space. I've dealt then with network time, network acoustic, performance, time, and shared space. As I said, so can we transpose these ideas that the network represents a kind of acoustic into an extended social space, an extended architectural space? And this idea of participative musical compositions, that the fact that the composer is no longer making the sound, but is just making the situation, this recalls a bit some of the writings of the French postmodernists, as well as Baudrillard in his simulations. And I follow this, and I start to wonder then, does this start to create what we call a social capital? And this is where, if I think about the industrial universe itself, the word capital is coming into this situation. It's capital not in terms of money, but capital in terms of what intellect does each of us bring to a situation here in one space. And if that is a shared situation, it becomes a social capital. Can we start to then use this dynamic to create music? No, because what I'm doing is not being sold. Yeah. That's why I say, I will play some sounds for you from this device, but I made it on my desk this week. It's not going to be next year's Walkman. Maybe this is my ambition. Yeah? And maybe I have tried to make contact with the Walkman group in Tokyo, but I can tell you the Sony Empire I mean, I can email, you know, and I'm Japanese and I can get through some channels. Our lab is 7 people in a little garden site courtyard in an academic neighborhood in Paris. So it's not marketing at all. In fact, if we work too closely to product, we are criticized in our lab. So maybe we are a little secret garden. Maybe I'm very lucky to be in that situation. And that's why I try to present it in this way. I'm not selling it. But I do say that that's where I work. And I do say that it's quite a unique situation that they allow me to bring all the elements that I presented in previous slides to what I'm doing there currently. And so what I'm about to show you on these small devices are not musical composition in this proposal, but those ideas transposed into this world. We'll hear some familiar music in new contexts. So yeah, so it's good. So that slide with the terminology of industry did trigger off the suspicious question. That's right. But let's step back for a moment. I'm not making next year's Walkman. I'm not here to sell you Sony. Look, I mean, I have an Apple computer, the PC is an IBM, and the PDA is Casio. Okay, so the question, well, I get to that just to say, because marketing seems like a kind of vicious thing. So I'm going to take advantage of you. I'm not into vicious things. I'm more into sensitive things. So the question is, how can we start to make sensitive music? We look back at history to the Middle Ages when, before the printing press, when people were able to remember and recount epic poems. How did these people remember these huge, huge pieces, bodies of works? Well, there were systems based on imagery and architecture called ars narrativa, place elements of a story in an imaginary space using iconography and imaginary images, that in telling the storyteller would walk through the space, and by doing so, it was kind of mnemonic to remember all the elements. And this is a well-known art. There is literature published in this area called ars narrativa. My question is, can we start to think about using these things to remember memorable music for us? Because if I start to bring up devices like this, Justin had another non-Sony product, the iPod. No, this is very good, because Sony is very, doesn't know how to do that. Because Apple beat Sony to punch. At the same time, oh, it's great, it's a beautiful piece of design, you've got your whole album collection on here, now it's selling to the iPod. But it's still a computer company. It's Apple's book. Apple makes beautiful interfaces, and they've got their beautiful interface now on a very small LCD. But what do? You scroll. You scroll through lists, and you've got your thousand songs and five. I mean, how many people on their iPods have gotten past the letter C? That's a problem. Can we start to use imagery and memory to look up songs instead of playlists and texts? Those are the kinds of questions that I'm starting to ask myself. Can we start to use gesture in the way that I was doing with these sensory instruments to send music from a Walkman to a home stereo system? These are demos that I have running in the lab. Can we create location-sensitive systems so that a sphere of music can follow this man around in the house? If you were waking up and turned on a piece of music and went to take a shower, would you like it? The music follows you. And indeed, marketing does enter the picture. Does all this mean we can have new points of commercial transaction or not? Yes, I do think about these things. I think about these things because other people in my company are worried. And Sony Music is all worried about music piracy and copying and all this and try to impose copyright control. And I say they're wrong. They're looking in the wrong place. They're looking at outdated laws. And there are going to be new ways. Yes, we're going to get things for free. Yes, people are going to be willing to pay for things, but maybe in different ways than the laws, the current laws stipulate. So I say this, I'm not working so much on it, I'm not in the context. what something I am working on is experience. Can we then, if we can share music, can we share an experience? Because after all, listening to music is a personal experience. It evokes events in our lives and memory. Are these things that also can be shared socially in the way that we share viewpoints and narratives? Now, I'm not the only one thinking about this. Just to cite related work in Dublin, there's the MIT Media Lab Europe. There's a very interesting project called Tuna, which I think means tune like iTunes, A for ad hoc. So it's a way for sharing music over these wireless networks. There's the Interactive Institute in Sweden that's got a system called Soundfire. The Victoria Institute, also in Sweden, has an interesting project called Sound City. And of course, the Apple has. But what are these things doing, where I seek to go further? Well, Tuna is ad hoc networks. Ad hoc, we'll see in a second, means a very spontaneous network that's not dependent on servers or infrastructure. But still, Tuna is just exchanging playlists. I want to get away from text. I want to get away from bits. I want to get to the music and to the experience. SoundPrior is interesting. They're dealing with cars, automobiles, making coming into close contact. Sonic City also, they're dealing with, much like what Justin presented, a walk through a city, a sound walk, but in an interactive way to create new compositions for such walks. And the Apple iPod is interesting as a product, but what's more interesting are the sociological side effects that have come out. There is an effect in New York called iPod jacking. And I don't know if you've heard about this, but iPod jacking has to do with people spotting other iPod listeners in something on the screen. Because the iPod headphones are quite distinctive, they're all white. They're this very, again, beautiful Apple design. When you're walking down the street in Manhattan, and you're wearing your iPod and your white headphones, and you see someone else with a white headphone. iPod jacking consists of going up to them and saying, oh, what are you listening to? And you jack it to their iPod and they jack it to yours. And then you see your friends are out and you go in separate ways. But it's interesting that that's happening. But it's happening in a kind of exclusive way. I've got the exclusive white headphones that I can go up and actually there to talk to a stranger. I've also got the exclusive white headphones. So, but it's interesting nonetheless. Okay, so location-sensitive restreaming. I won't be able to show you here, but the idea was that you would hold in your hand a PDA like this that was a graphical display that had a wireless internet interface and that had location tracking, much in the way that we all fear, we're going to be following you around in the streets and indeed you advertising when you're walking in front of a flower shop. Well, again, can we use that scary industrial technology in a more humanistic and sensitive way? Can we just use it in your house and say, okay, when I go from my bedroom to the bathroom to the living room, can the music that I started to play in the bedroom through a gesture like throwing it to the speakers there then naturally follow me to the living room? To create a sense which sound is omnipresent. We can build walls to start to block sound. But it can seep out in ways that might not. So can we start to exploit our sensation of sound as an ubiquitous medium, but start to mold it and sculpt it? Because if the sound was all over our house, indeed it would be ubiquitous. But if my girlfriend got home and didn't like to eat pizza, she wanted to hide in the bedroom, what would she do? Instead, we create spheres, personal spheres of sound around us, so that the experience is locally ubiquitous. As I move from the bedroom to the living room, the sound follows me, the sphere follows me. But for me, the sound is just always with me. So can we start to think about experience in this way? In this experience sharing, can we start to bootstrap ephemeral networks? This is a demo that I will show you called B-Moto, like iPod jacking, running into someone on the street. But let's say now it's not a stranger wearing the cool headphones. Let's say we run into a friend on the street. So touches Brandon LaBelle. He is. So I will try to, let's see, maybe we can get the camera going now. So I've got two devices and I'm going to simulate a situation. So a lot of what's going on will be happening on these little screens and little speakers. So we will do our best to show you what's happening. Okay. So how's our... Oh, yes. Okay. So let's see if we can get Brandon's screen. Okay. Well, it's the Sony Magic System. I didn't know what to call it. There is no interface, yeah. But let's suppose I'm walking down the street in Manhattan and I'm running to Brandon. Oh, long time no see you. Are we in this marketing association? What are you listening to under a cool Sony walkman? Well, he says, well, he could share it. So he's going to invite me to his personal network. So let's keep you on camera. This is going to be hard. And he's just going to beam me. Okay. Do you want to accept? I thought said it. So as I said, there's no interface at all. I say yes. Okay. And I'm sharing a network with Brandon. We bootstrapped our little Wi-Fi cards. Now I'm making connection. He may have passed me a password, an encryption key. And we have bootstrapped an ad hoc Wi-Fi network. We have Wi-Fi here in the house, but this is a network that's invisible to the network that's in the house. It's a network where only Brandon and I exist. And now I can start to type in. Now I will. There's nothing so sexy. It's just an idea. But this little snippet of a Beatles song is now playing out through my Walkman. But where is it coming from? You see the flashing light on Brandon's Walkman. It's being served from his PDA. Okay? So it's the music that maybe he's been listening to on his PDA and his Walkman and headphones. He's allowed me to join him on his network as we've come now. It's been fast enough that we can just run into each other in the street and say, oh, beam, okay. I'm going to pick up what you've been listening to. We are temporarily sharing this experience. If Brandon now says, well, see you later, yeah. and he goes out of range and turns off his phone, the music has stopped. So the music was being streamed live from that very small mobile device to this very small mobile device. So the kinds of dynamic that we've been used to in going up to internet servers, download files, stream files, and listen to internet radio, we're making possible now on not just the mobile, yeah. How does it differ from beatbox culture? In what way? Well, I would like to take it, I would like to get these companies and devices to actually catch up with beatbox culture. Yeah? So it doesn't differ. What differs is the ways that we can make this very easy. Yeah? Because still, there's no interface. What you saw, I was typing in an IP address, but it was relatively painless to get a secure personal sphere going. Because I didn't have to say, here is my password. oh, okay, here is my network number, here's my encryption key. Or we didn't have to say, well, let's see, where is there a Wi-Fi hotspot around here? Is there an internet cafe? No, we could do it anywhere. We could run into each other on the street, we could get a network going. It's a secure network among friends. Other people could be walking by with similar devices, they wouldn't see us. So all I'm trying to say is that we can start to define temporary ephemeral infrastructures based on friendship and social life that allows us to share, in this case, a song. Does that start to answer your question? So when you've exchanged your phone, you've done the first step of this. Indeed, I use infrared to say, okay, I'll beam you the secure information. But we use that then to bootstrap a wider network, this Wi-Fi network, because that music wouldn't have passed over the infrared. We would have had this, okay. No, the concept goes one step further because we're using two infrastructures, one to bootstrap the second. And that's the key element, because the second one exists, Wi-Fi exists. But the question is, can it be secure? How easily can people catch hotspots and so forth? Can we start to do this in the absence of hotspots? And this little telephone number exchange is the key element of bootstrapping that wire. Okay, but still, we haven't gone far enough because somehow the music hasn't changed. Yeah, we're still just listening to another MP3 file, a well-known song and so forth. But can we start to then use this mobile dynamic to make music more malleable? Can we possibly do remixes on the run, mobile remixes? Can we start to sense whether people are getting into music or not? So these are the questions that I'm trying to address in the second demo that I was trying to show you, where I enlist the help of Achim and Justin. So what I will show you, there's going to be three devices here. Let's see. Okay, the music you will hear is, again, not my music. It's one bar, one measure that I've taken from a rhythm track of meters. Come back as the demo. One PDA is going to be controlling the vocal melody. I don't know whether it's, I think that's occupying doing that either. And then PDA 2, I don't have the second one, so in fact, Justin will be simulating that from the computer screen. We'll be controlling the drum pattern. And then I will myself be using this very strange device. We'll see what it does. And in fact, well, this is the question I'll get back to after. So let's switch to the camera again. Yeah. And let me get this over. Oh no, sorry. Let's stay on the. Let me see if I can just get this over here. This is much better. Okay. So this is basically what is on each PDA. We're going to say here that this is what Achim will be playing. My strange control will control this, and the other one, Justin, will be playing this, and I will play that. Let me open up the... Hello. Open this. It works to sleep. Alright, so server has to wake up. The idea that I'm trying to implement here is that now we want to make music malleable. We want to get away from this idea of copying songs or listening to radio streams and so forth. I'm setting up a kind of music engine in server space that can dynamically re-sculpt music on the fly and send it back to the different clients who are connected.
Oh, it's beautiful. Want to put a link.
So there is an element in server space. It's no longer a file server. It's a music server. It's a music engine, right? And maybe we'll get a glimpse of it in a moment. Each of the connected devices are small mobile devices similar to this one that are making a wireless internet connection with the server. But there's a kind of a back channel, so we're able to stream music into the device. But there's a back channel where we're able to get user actions from the device. You see a bank of faders, looks a bit like a mixing board. So yeah, it's indeed, maybe we could mix things, but there have been projects like this to do interactive music. And I'm starting to look at ways that maybe we can start to use the experience I have in building the sensor instruments to start to capture more intuitive, more natural gestures and have them have a kind of meaningful impact on the music. And once this music engine collects all this input from the various connected users, because we're dealing with a society of connected users, can this have a meaningful result on one piece of music? Can this be that redistributed and shared back out to the connected peers?
I've run out of words and the windows are still running open. No, it's not doing this. Amazing. There should be a little scroll button going. No, because I had this over there. So I will start, I will shut the whole thing down.
So the idea that I tried to get to with this device then was to start to say, well, I mean, I'm saying contradictory things. I'm saying I'm not making next year's walk back. At the same time, I'm using a PDA and calling it a lockdown to get the touch with the system. Indeed, it would be nice if a lockdown could have a graphical interface as pretty as this screen and could have a live network connection.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I really didn't like that.
Okay. So, what I started to ask is, well, what if I'm sort of against this idea of the iPod scrolling through a playlist of text, well then I started to ask myself, well, it's just music after all, it's sound. Do we really need a pretty graphical interface system? I mean, a mixing board, I know how to use it as a musician. But this is exactly where all these CD-ROM and the web-based interactive music projects fail. No one really wants to feel like they're going into Peter Gabriel's recording studio to mix the song. That's not what's going to create experience. So I started to wonder if I could just take away the graphic interface from the mobile device, and this is what I end up with. So let me log into my screen. So this is a mobile device, not as pretty as the PDA, but it's got no screen, it's just got some speakers, a little bit more potent, beefier than the speakers with PDA. And it's got this strange circuitry in the back, and this is going to be my back channel taking me on my gestures back up to the server. An error. The system has recovered from serious error. We'll keep going.
That's what you mean?
Yeah. So what I will do here is to start up what's called an Icecast server, a streaming MP3 server. So I will change directory. Okay. Start Icecast. Syntax again. CD. Space. Okay. Icecast -C. Okay, so I've got a server started up. I will start up my sound engine.
Well, so this back channel up here is a couple of sensors. You see this sort of hundred pads on the side. It's already dealing with the pressure point, but how hard and gripping the body of the device. And it's all the circuitry is digitized back, send that back up over the wireless connection to the server.
So here the idea is that I'm not dealing with a graphical interface, I'm not dealing with gators, I just want to do something.
That's what the system involves. And I want to be able to pick up whether I'm getting into the music or not. So with all that being said, let's see if that it all works.
Okay. The program is reading. This won't be very long, because I have a feeling I'm going quite over time. Are there any other questions about my work? Okay. It's there. Now we just have to send it out to the screen. So, encode, icecast. Login. Set. Okay. So let's see what happens, for example, when Achim connects. So he's got the same thing on this little device. And we're not hearing much, are we? Here's what Justin's doing.
And if I turn on this guy,
okay.
So we start to slowly hear a bit of a kind of music. Now imagine that we're sort of here in the same space, but somewhere about town. We'll hear that, the same thing over here. So if we're in three distinct separate spaces, we're somehow getting something that resembles the same music, yeah? Now who's doing what? This is a good problem. What I'm doing is I'm controlling the filter on these things, the second and fourth faders, so I can bring up the vocals with a little thumb pressure. That second one goes up, we hear the vocals better, I can back off. So that's been happening, that's my input, yeah? And my other hand is this one, so I can bring up the drums, and these guys are controlling the melodic pattern. So each of us has a kind of contribution to the total music. It's far from being a song, but I've just taken one sample, yeah? And suddenly the melody has changed because Achim has found a kind of interesting melody.
And those you can see in the interface, what's happening at the sound server is a different series of cutouts.
There's total latency.
That's why.
Yeah.
There's no, it's a big sort of, because none of us are hearing the same thing at the same time. But that's okay, because we're not together. Suppose he's across town, and we know, oh, Achim is coming to my sort of range, you know. Well, there he is. And this is one measure of music that we can start to play with and keep going. Well, I'm over time now, but this is not even 5 seconds of music that could give us kind of pleasure or satisfaction for 5 minutes or so. So if we can do this with one bar from one rhythm, what if we started to compose pieces of music for this kind of situation, for this kind of infrastructure? Maybe this would lead to new forms of music, new forms. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
We're not going to take a break. It's the last part, and I'm trying to be brief. It's nice to be back. I've been here before, and that was basically because of the architectural work that I do, and tonight I'm here because I'm a musician or a composer or a person dealing with sound as well. And it's nice to be back anyway, because I found this. This is London for 40 minutes, 1977, so that was the first time I was here, and that's a bit of past, and it's all black and white. A bit of a past, because of course 77 was a good time in London. I was just about getting my high school degree, and friend and I sort of extemporated, so this is we tried to meet on the Piccadilly Circus because that was supposed to be a good place, and he didn't show up, and I was just in the Piccadilly Circus sitting and waiting for him, and then these three punk kids showed up, and they carried a box, and of course there were hippies all around the Piccadilly Circus sitting on the right next to the fountain, and kids just threw the box into the fountain, and there was a big splash, and then the place was empty. And I was kind of a funnel for me, or kind of a sign for the new time that was going to arrive. And so London is always a relief for me, which basically has to do with being a German. Music was always like protest, or at least for my generation. A protest against the generation of the fathers. So experimental music always meant like doing something else, or questioning the things that had been done up to then. And so I'm trying to be brief. So it's just 2 points that I'm trying to question right now. The one thing is, what is a composition, and the other thing is, what is an interface? The composition question is basically about what are you doing if you compose. I mean, architects in a way also compose, and a composition is something that's done beforehand to be executed or played afterwards. So the idea is, the question behind it, touching the topic of social music, is what empowers you, or what gives you the right to do something beforehand as an individual that's later then to be executed, or done, or played by a crowd of people whom you sort of direct So what's the right you have to direct people? So the other point that's connected to this question is why can you dominate an audience by playing something? So what's the right, or gives you the right to dominate an audience that's presumably staying silent while the composition is being executed or played? So that's kind of interesting in a political way. Also artistically, I think, because if you really question the social position of the artist today, you're not empowered by anything. You're happy if you survive economically. So the power you have to sort of function in this kind of system is not even borrowed. Something that works on an ideological base that you're not controlling. So the other question is, do you want to control it? Why do you want to control it if you want to? And what could this control be about in terms of composition, composing, putting pieces together, later on, so far, executing it? Okay. So what I wonder is whether technology brings freedom or another chapter of ideological framework, of course it's both. But in terms of composition, there's one thing that is probably pretty interesting because composition now can be a composition of composition in terms of something being programmed that interacts with something that's not been there before. So you're not controlling material that you sort of find and transform in the perspective of this material being multiplied or sort of dealt with later, but you deal with this kind of material in real time. So that's the basic difference. Just to give you another example or a metaphor, right now, music pieces cannot be just played or being played, but they can also hear in terms of the audience being able to sort of interfere with the music piece because real-time composition is possible, as Atal just demonstrated. Pictures can see it, so any kind of surface, flat surface, or also spatial construction can be network monitor, and any input can generate direct code. So a composition can then become, I hope I'm not too abstract, here I am, but anyway, if you imagine real time as something of, like Justin demonstrated, a cityscape, some soundscape that's just happening, then composition would be just an array of technical possibilities that would hover on top or underneath this kind of real-time thing and would interact while the whatever soundscape underneath is moving as well. So composition is not something that's preconceived once to be repeated all over, but it's something that is sort of preconceived as a thing to change in real time and do change to the stuff that's feeding. So it's picking up material while it's changing itself. It's like a little spacecraft that's moving on top of the sound and changing it while it's moving. So that, of course, the question that then arises, I mean, this is pretty theoretical, is how do you design this? I mean, there's got to be ways to sort of interfere with this object, because basically the easiest interface we have is like the keyboard. So it's supposedly the natural way to be able to talk to a machine. The machine talks back to you. It's funny, this funny thing that sort of supposes you interact on a personal. It's kind of a fake dialogue that you have with the machine. Right? It's of course not a dialogue because you speak to like thousands of programmers who did this before. You notice if this fails, then of course you have to call like 20 people to actually run it again. So it's not a dialogue, it's a polylogue. But so the question is, how do you design an interface? And the interface that I come across is, the first thought that I have is, or had is, it's strange to have like just one keyboard. Maybe you could have bigger keyboards. Different symbols, or 20 A's, 20 A's, 40 B's, whatever. And you have like a multitude of people interacting with the keyboard, maybe a large screen, or several screens that sort of build up a space. And then I figured it's still kind of a symbolic exchange that sort of excludes movement, for example, movement in space. And so what I think is going to be the next step in artistic production with real-time composition, both in acoustic and visual arts, is that people sort of interact with space as interface, and they interact not just with monitoring, but also with groups that also use the space. So it's kind of a mixture of man-machine interaction, man-man interaction, machine-machine interaction in terms of the program that uses it, and uses the input, and basically the output is coincidental, or it's the same as the input. So the interface is not just input area, it's also output area in terms of the sound that's being, for example, recorded, played, or the visuals recorded, played, happen in the same space the input speed. So what I'm using here is I don't want to show visuals. Maybe I can do that later, but I don't want to overfed this. It's PD. This is public domain software in terms of there's a group of people developing it. It's kind of a sequencing software. What it does is it changes sound. And what I want to do, to be brief, is I need volunteers. And, okay, this is the wrong one. I need 3 volunteers. Okay. I was writing a text, and the text happens from the combination, and I want somebody, or 3 persons, to read it. And so the point is that I want I'll also read it, part of it, and if you hear the transformation, you can get the other people reading, and close for it. Brandon says that we shall not reserve. I need a mailbox. He's going to do it. But you're going to be now. Because the mic is up front here. Otherwise, you don't have to. One more volunteer. Okay. You got enough light? There. Could we have more light in the back?